welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, you will hear stories from Brian Lynn and John Russell. Later, Jill Robbins presents an everyday grammar lesson that centers on one punctuation mark, the possessive apostrophe. Finally, Katie Weaver and I take you on a journey to Crater Lake National Park. But first,
an international group of astronomers has joined efforts seeking to establish a separate time zone for the moon. The French-based International Astronomical Union, IAU, recently approved a resolution on the matter during the group's General Assembly meeting in Cape Town, South Africa. The resolution calls on space organizations around the world to cooperate on establishing a standard clock for the moon. The moon's orbital movements around Earth make one day on the lunar surface equal to 29.5 Earth days. And because the moon has less gravity compared to Earth, time moves slightly faster there, about 58.7 microseconds quicker each day. Susan Stewart is an astronomer with the U.S. Naval Observatory. She helped create the resolution at the IAU conference. Stewart told the Associated Press, "The aim of the measure is quite simple: to work together to establish a standard time. Currently, moon operations run on the time of the country that is launching spacecraft. But supporters of creating a separate time zone say this method will have to change. More countries and private space companies are starting to launch their own moon missions." Last year, the European Space Agency, ESA, pushed for the creation of a lunar clock. And earlier this year, the White House directed the U.S. Space Agency, NASA, and other agencies to come up with a timekeeping plan for the moon by the end of 2026. ESA noted communication and navigation systems built for the moon will perform much better if they use the same timescale. In addition, a separate time zone will support the many other crewed and uncrewed missions planned for the future, ESA said. In the past, NASA also considered establishing a separate time zone for the International Space Station, ISS. But the agency decided against it. Instead, the ISS runs on Coordinated Universal Time, or UTC, which is based on time kept by atomic clocks. NASA officials say this system helps ease the time difference between NASA and the Canadian Space Agency, as well as other space partners in Russia, Japan, and Europe. The international team looking at establishing a lunar time zone has said it is still deciding whether a single organization should be chosen to set and keep time on the moon. Bijunath Patla is a physicist at the U.S. Commerce Department's National Institute of Standards and Technology. He told the AP that astronomers are still deciding on how a lunar clock would work. Patla said, "I think the community has realized that this needs to be done, and this is the beginning." I'm Brian Lynn.
A plan to build a huge solar farm in Australia is a step closer after the Australian government gave environmental approvals for the $19 billion project recently. Australian company SunCable plans to build a 12,400-hectare solar farm in a remote area of northern Australia. The farm will send electricity to the city of Darwin via an 800-kilometer overhead transmission line. Then the power will be transported to large industrial customers in Singapore through a 4,300-kilometer submarine cable. The Australia-Asia Power Link project aims to deliver up to 6 gigawatts of green electricity each year. Such a project, Australian Environment Minister Tanya Plibersek suggested, would help turn Australia into a renewable energy superpower and boost its economy. Plibersek said in a written statement, "It will be the largest solar precinct in the world." The project was first backed by Australian mining businessman Andrew Forrest and Atlassian co-founder Mike Cannon-Brooks. The plans were discussed during a state visit by then-Singapore Prime Minister Lee Hsien Loong and Australian Prime Minister Anthony Albanese as part of a Green Economy Agreement in 2022. In January 2023, the project collapsed when SunCable was involved in a financing dispute between Forrest and Cannon-Brooks. By May of that year, a group led by Cannon-Brooks's Grok Ventures acquired the company, finalizing the takeover in September 2023. SunCable Australia's managing director Cameron Garnsworthy said it was pleased to have cleared a major legal issue. He added that the company will now put its efforts into the next stage of planning to work towards a final investment decision targeted by 2027. The company said electricity supply would begin in the early 2030s. Energy has been a politically charged issue for nearly 20 years in Australia. The country depends on coal and gas, as well as money from exporting those fuels, to help support its economy. This dependence on fossil fuels has historically made it one of the world's worst greenhouse gas emitters on a per capita basis. Australia's main opposition party in June announced plans to build the country's first nuclear power plants as early as 2035. The announcement ensures the major parties will be divided on how to reduce Australia's greenhouse gas emissions at elections due within a year. The parties have not gone to an election with the same carbon reduction policies since 2007. I'm John Russell.
The battle for the White House is set as Vice President Kamala Harris officially accepts the Democratic Party nomination on Thursday to run against former President Donald Trump, the Republican nominee. However, another fight is just starting among grammar nerds over where to put the possessive apostrophe after her name. Is it Harris apostrophe or Harris apostrophe S? Eric Turkowitz, a New York lawyer, called the debate apostrophe hell on the social media website X. It has since received more than 2 million views. The Associated Press style book says, use only an apostrophe for singular proper names ending in the letter S, such as Dickens's, that's Dickens apostrophe, book, Hercules's, Hercules apostrophe, labors, or Jesus's, Jesus apostrophe, life. So for Harris, it is Harris, followed by an apostrophe, as in Harris's policy. The AP style book is widely used as the standard by American news organizations, but not everyone agrees. Three large U.S. newspapers, the New York Times, the Washington Post, and the Wall Street Journal, all use Harris, followed by an apostrophe, and the letter S, as in Harris's policy. Adding to the confusion, they all agree that the singular possessive for Harris's running mate, Minnesota Governor Tim Walz, is Walz apostrophe S. As for the plural possessive, it is Harrises apostrophe, or Harris's, as in Harris's family home, and Walzes apostrophe, as in Walz's cats. Benjamin Dreyer is a retired editor who worked for the publisher Random House. He wrote Dreyer's English, an utterly correct guide to clarity in style. He told the AP there is widespread agreement that Walz apostrophe S is correct, but many flooded him with questions about what to do with the apostrophe after Harris. Add the apostrophe and the letter S, Dreyer said. To set the apostrophe S is just simpler, and then you can take your valuable brain cells and apply them to more important things. The American dictionary publisher Merriam-Webster joined the debate with this reminder. For names that end in an S or Z sound, you can either add apostrophe S or just an apostrophe. Going with apostrophe S is the more common choice. The car that belongs to Jones, J-O-N-E-S apostrophe S car, or J-O-N-E-S apostrophe car. Amanda Barrett is AP's vice president for news standards and inclusion. She said, while the AP style has evolved over the years, there are no plans to change the guidance on the possessive apostrophe S. Barrett added, we do know that the conversation is out there, and people make different choices when it comes to grammar, and that's all fine. Everyone makes a choice that works best for them. Timothy Pulliu teaches linguistics at Dartmouth College in New Hampshire. He said that until the 17th or 18th century, the possessive of proper names ending in the letter S, such as Jesus or Moses, often was simply the name itself with no apostrophe or additional S. Eventually, the apostrophe, Jesus apostrophe or Moses apostrophe, was added to mark the possession, although the pronunciation remained the same. That became kind of the standard that I was taught and adhere to, even though in retrospect, I don't think it's a great standard, he said. Pulliu expects most people will use the apostrophe followed by the letter S form over time. As long as people are communicating successfully, we say language is doing what it's supposed to be doing, he said. If you can read it, whichever way it's written, then it seems like it's working for people. Michael Dukakis of Massachusetts was the last U.S. presidential candidate whose name ended with the letter S. Dukakis told the AP that he does not remember any similar discussion when he was a Democratic nominee. But he agrees with the AP. "It sounds to me like it would be S apostrophe and that's it," he said. If Harris wins in November, she would become the fourth U.S. president with a last name ending in the letter S, and the first since Rutherford B. Hayes, who was elected in 1876. The Harris campaign has yet to take a clear position. Press releases issued by the campaign talked about Harris's, that's with an apostrophe S, positive vision, and Harris's, S apostrophe, seventh trip to Nevada. I'm Jill Robbins.
Jill Robbins is here now to talk more about that everyday grammar lesson. Hi, Jill. Thanks for being here.
I'm always happy to talk with our podcast listeners.
I was wondering if we could talk a bit more about the punctuation question in this week's Everyday Grammar.
Sure. It is a question that has come up because the Democratic nominees for president and vice president both have names that end with a sound that's similar to our possessive in English.
Yes, so that would be Kamala Harris and Tim Walz. And we usually add an apostrophe, a little mark next to the last letter of a name, and the letter S to show possession.
Exactly. The problem is you end up with two sounds that are the same next to each other. Take my name, Jill Robbins. Using my first name is okay. Jill's book is easy. Jill apostrophe S. But add the apostrophe after my last name and you get Dr. Robbins's class. I'd write that R-O-B-B-I-N-S apostrophe.
I noticed you added another sound after your name, Robbins's. The issue is, how do you write that?
We used to follow the rule that you just add the punctuation mark, the apostrophe, and when you say it, you add the reduced vowel sound, before the S sound. But now, people have started applying the rule where you write another S after the apostrophe.
So it would be written R-O-B-B-I-N-S apostrophe S?
That's it. Similar to how I said I'd write my first name with an apostrophe S, Jill's book. It's just another example of how language changes and people start to make new rules.
Well, thanks for being with us today, Jill, and thanks for explaining the possessive apostrophe.
It's always a pleasure, Ashley.
On our national parks journey, we travel to the northwestern state of Oregon. Here, you will find a huge, deep lake. Its waters seem impossibly blue. It is the deepest lake in America and one of the deepest lakes in the world. Its water is among the clearest and purest found on Earth. Around the lake runs the wall of an extinct volcano. In the middle of the lake, a small island rises over 230 meters above the surface. Welcome to Crater Lake National Park.
The lake's beauty inspires artists, photographers, and nature lovers. That beauty was born from the violent burst of Mount Mazama, about 7,700 years ago. Hot liquid, called magma, rose from deep under the mountain, causing it to collapse. The powerful burst destroyed the surrounding area. Huge amounts of ash fell on the land. The burst also left an enormous circular hole in the mountain's center. Scientists call this a caldera. Over the next hundreds of years, rain and snow filled the hole with water. Rainfall and snowfall are the lake's only source of water. It has no connections to the rivers and streams around it. That is what keeps its waters so pure. As water collected, plants began to grow in the area again, and animals returned. Scientists say it took about 250 years for the lake to rise to its current water level. Crater Lake is 592 meters deep. It is one of the 10 deepest on Earth. But its depth is not the only remarkable quality. People are awed by its water color and clarity. Crater Lake is so clear that on most days you can see nearly 30 meters below the surface. The lake takes on its intense blue color because of the water's clarity. Sunlight reaches deep into the water. Crater Lake gets its name from geology. A crater is a large, bowl-shaped area on top of a volcano. The crater that formed the lake sits within the larger caldera.
Native Americans were in the area even before the lake's formation. Researchers have found artifacts buried under layers of ash and dust from Mount Mazama's huge eruption. Following the burst, Native Americans considered Crater Lake to be a holy place. Ancient Native American stories describe the eruption of Mount Mazama. European explorers and settlers did not arrive in the area until the middle 1800s. In 1865, a hunter became one of the first non-Native Americans to reach the shores of Crater Lake. In 1870, a boy in Kansas read a newspaper article about the strange lake in Oregon. The story about Crater Lake fascinated the young William Gladstone Steele. He promised himself he would one day see this lake. In 1872, Steele's family moved to Portland, Oregon, about 375 kilometers north of the lake. 13 years later, Steele honored his promise and visited Crater Lake. Its beauty moved him greatly. He began a 17-year fight to preserve the area as a public park. Steele was a writer. He described one of his first visits to Crater Lake in 1886 in the West Shore magazine.
"Not a foot of the land about the lake has been touched or claimed. An overmastering conviction came to me that this wonderful spot must be saved, wild and beautiful, just as it was, for all future generations.
His proposal of creating a national park did not please nearby sheep herders and miners. But his efforts succeeded anyway. On May 22, 1902, Crater Lake became the country's fifth national park. It remains the only national park in Oregon. And William Gladstone Steele is called the father of Crater Lake.
Crater Lake National Park covers 740 square kilometers. The lake itself makes up less than 10% of the park. It also includes surrounding mountains and thick forests. The trees shelter many kinds of animals, from black bears to elk to spotted owls. About 480,000 people visit Crater Lake National Park each year. They explore by car, bicycle, or on foot. Roads that encircle Crater Lake usually are open from July through October, depending on weather. They provide breathtaking displays of the lake's unusual blue color, as well as the forests around it. Crater Lake National Park also has more than 140 kilometers of hiking trails. The Cleetwood Cove Trail drops more than 200 meters down to the edge of Crater Lake. It leads to a spot where swimming is permitted. The water is extremely cold. Most swimmers cannot stay in for more than a few minutes. Crater Lake's average water temperature is just 3 degrees Celsius. In summer, the lake's surface warms to about 10 degrees Celsius.
Visitors can also catch a boat from the end of Cleetwood Cove Trail. Park rangers lead visitors on boat rides around the lake. Visitors can also take boats to Wizard Island. The piece of land sits in the western part of the lake. Volcanic eruptions formed Wizard Island. It rises over 760 meters above the lake floor. However, most of the island, about 500 meters, is underwater. At Wizard Island, visitors can hike, swim, and fish. It is also a wonderful place to relax and enjoy nature. But such extraordinary places can be found all over the park. Discovering one's own is part of the magic to experience at Crater Lake National Park. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Katie Weaver.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.